Investment is when the business involves a stepwise and sequential conversion of raw material into a finished product. Say, for example, I have started a small unit somewhere in Jalna. Okay, I have started a small unit somewhere in Jalna. Getting it? So I have started a small unit somewhere in Jalna and I have started manufacturing some intermediates. Okay, and now these intermediates are being manufactured for a large API unit wherein I'm supplying these intermediates. Okay, after some time, maybe I would want to either have some collaboration with this API unit, so there would be continual manufacturing of my intermediate. Number one, I could do that. Or secondly, maybe I would want to start my own API unit. Okay, I would want to go for a business integration between myself and the company which was buying the intermediates from me, or I would want to advance it further and I would want to start my own API unit. So this is what I would want to have. Or what I could do is I could go further. Okay, the API is being sent to a formulation unit where it is being manufactured into tablets, liquid oral and so on. I would want to say, for example, go ahead and start my own formulation unit. So this is something I remember Hindustan Antibiotics did. They used to manufacture a lot of antibiotics and then they thought of, you know, diversifying and also having a formulation development unit next to their antibiotic unit. So this is something you could do and that is known as a business integration investment. And last kind of investment where minimal investment is required is known as the innovation incubation concept leading to a startup. Now, startup is something where you usually go for the minimal investments, but you rely more on your innovation, on idea and on technologies. So this is where an entrepreneur would want to invest as far as the product is concerned. Now, this is the equation of a product induction. If I want to come up with a good product in the market, okay, then these are some things that I should consider. Number one is product selection. Number two is innovation and creativity. Number three is material selection, technology, and product design. Now, when you talk about innovation, creativity, material selection, technology, product design, all these are part and parcel of the R&D. Okay, so we are talking about R&D assisted choice of technology. Remember, our heading. Okay, mechanism of product selection and R&D assisted choice of technology. Okay, so this equation considers both product selection, which is very important. You start off with the right kind of product, innovation and creativity, then you have material selection, technology and product design, which are all assisted by the research and development unit, and finally you come up with a product. So let's come to the first part of that particular equation, and that is, what is product selection? So product selection is a decision process in which the producer selects one or few product concepts for further development based on the need and demand of the consumer. Now the key word over here is need and demand of the consumer. You don't go for a blind product selection. You want to start a manufacturing unit for a particular product, or you want to come up with an idea and convert it into a startup product, or you want to come up with a particular kind of services. So you want to know whether this service is required or whether it is in demand as far as the consumer is concerned. Okay, so C value is good when it is a buy value. Okay, so you create something, but that what you have created should have takers. Only if it has takers will what you have created pay back. Okay, so that is very important. So you should have an idea as to the need and demand of the consumer, which is the key word for the product selection or the decision for a particular type of product. Now let us see what are the considerations for product selection. First and foremost, as I said, demand is very important. So there is something known as a demand supply characteristics. Here I have mentioned two types of products where demand and supply characteristics play a very important role. First is the standard product and the second one is a job order product. A standard product is a product which is, say for example, a fast moving consumer good or a consumer durable or what you call it as a white goods. White goods we are talking about appliances and so on, which most of the people would desire sometime or the other in their lifestyle. Okay, so that becomes a standard product. The other kind of product is a job order product. A job order product, you manufacture only based on the order that you have received for that particular product. Say for example, I talked about an intermediate. You are manufacturing that intermediate for what purpose? For the purpose of the manufacturing unit which requires that intermediate for manufacturing APIs, active pharmaceutical ingredient. Okay, you are, say for example, manufacturing excipients. Why are you manufacturing those excipients? You are manufacturing those excipients because that is needed for a formulation unit for manufacturing their dosage forms. Okay, so why would you manufacture, say for example, starch? Why would you manufacture, say, different types of disintegrants? Or why would you manufacture coating agents? So you would be doing that because it is needed. Okay, so there will be orders placed to you and accordingly you would be manufacturing that for against that particular order. Okay, similarly, high-end services. So high-end services will be provided only if there is an order for the sale. Okay, so that is known as the job order product. So in the standard product, you don't really seek to understand the kind of demand because you know that it exists. Okay, but in the case of the job order product, it is very essential that you have the demand in advance so that you could manufacture and supply the same. Okay, now the next is the frequency of consumption. This is also very important. So when you're going for a product selection, why this is important? Because if there is a high frequency of consumption, say for example, in the case of fast moving consumer goods, shampoos, toothpaste, toiletries, soaps and so on. So there is a very high demand for the same in the market. And if you want to stand in the market, if you want to compete in the market, you need to flood the market. You need to flood the market. Okay, so that is unique characteristics as far as the FMCG products are concerned. And there is other kind of products which are consumer durable products which you need to manufacture and you need to store. So there is an extra cost of storage. Okay, so that is something that you need to consider while you are going for product selection as far as the consumer durables are concerned. Now next is the nature of use. Now there are two business models that I want you to understand. One business model is known as the B2B business model and the other is known as the B2C business model. A B2B business model is a business model which is between two businesses. Okay, so I manufacture something, Varroc manufactures the automobile spare parts for Bajaj. So one business unit is manufacturing spare parts so that the other unit can prepare their products. So it is business to business. Okay, so this sort of a business model. You have another business model where you go for B to B to C. Okay, so B to B and then B will finally provide that to C, the consumer. Or directly you could have B to C. Okay, so the motorcycles are produced by Bajaj and they are handed over to the consumer. Okay, so that is a B to C business. So the nature of use could be an industrial good which is being prepared for the other industry which needs to, say for example, you could, again the same intermediates, or we are talking about various excipients, or we are talking about APIs which are being used for the final formulation. Okay, or we are talking about machineries which are required by the industrial unit. We are talking about plants, or we are talking about isolators, or you know, for an advanced aseptic unit, or we are talking about, say for example, an RPS systems. All these systems are prepared or manufactured so that it can be used by the industry. Okay, so these are known as the industrial goods. And you have the consumer goods, B2C business model, the consumer goods where we are manufacturing directly for the consumer. Okay, then lastly, we'll talk about the product characteristics. Now this is if you are already having a unit, okay, and you are talking about diversification of the unit.